Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another exciting episode of Social Thought. My name is Michael Davis, and on today's episode, we have running for New York State Senate, Terry Gibson. We're going to talk about gun control, why he is the best possible candidate running for Senate right now, and we are also going to talk about the state of education for today's youth. All that and more on today's episode of Social Thought.
And maybe I don't care about the consequences. I'm on fire.
How you doing, Mr. Terry Gibson?
I'm doing good.
Welcome, nice to meet you. Social Thought. I'm very excited to interview you. So excited right now.
Well, I'm excited to be interviewed.
Thank you. Yeah. All right, so here we go. First question for you, sir. You are heavily involved in the community, all right, and not-for-profits for the last 25 years. To be precise, how important is it for somebody running for senator to understand the community and their surroundings?
Well, it's incredibly important. You're running to represent the community that is in your district. Mm-hmm. Every part of New York State, every part of the country is different.
Yes.
They have different interests, different priorities, different needs. And so if you're not connected with the community that you're running to represent, it's difficult to know how best to serve that community.
And you're running for the 41st district.
I'm running for the 41st state senate district, which covers Dutchess and Putnam County here in the Hudson Valley.
Very nice. Yeah. Very nice. All right. When it comes to the Hudson Valley, localism, we're going to talk about local businesses right now. Localism has become a new business model that is restoring the economic growth.
Right.
All right. Which has led to a high attraction of businesses coming in. How do we keep the balance and maintain our local residents and our business owners?
Well, we need to find more ways to make it possible for entrepreneurs, small business owners here in the Hudson Valley to hire local people. Part of the problem we've had in the past is that many of our jobs have been shipped out upstate or out of the country. And so I'm looking for creative ways to make it possible for people that want to start businesses here in the Hudson Valley to hire people locally to live in their communities.
Really? Nice. What are those plans to create more jobs, actually?
Well, I think that there ought to be a special type of loan set aside in New York State for entrepreneurs and small business owners that are willing to hire people within their community to help them start up a business or grow a business. And I think that one of the biggest expenses employers have is employees, especially a small businessman. If we could give them a loan to help pay part of their employee salary to allow them to be able to grow and become successful and also keep that money invested in a local community, I think that's one way that we can grow our local economy.
Beautiful. That's awesome. Right now, there's a high number of high school dropouts. All right. As senator, what are the initiatives you will create to increase student retention? And what type of educational programs are needed in this area to develop our youth and make our community better?
Well, really, one of the first things that we have to do is make sure that every public school system is being funded properly. Mm-hmm. We have a real uneven method of funding in New York State right now, and not every community is getting the funding they need to really be competitive. To say it simply, poor communities receive less money from New York State than wealthy communities in terms of public school education. It has a lot to do with the surrounding property values that surround a school. And I think that it's time that we just reform our entire funding mechanism so that every school gets the funding they need to make sure that every child gets a quality education regardless of the zip code that they live in. That's the first thing that we need to do.
Okay. The school-to-prison pipeline refers to the policies and practices that push our nation's school children, especially our most at-risk children, out of classrooms and into the juvenile and criminal justice systems. What are the type of services needed to help our school children focus better and go beyond their greatness?
Well, first of all, I just think we should be building more schools and less prisons.
Yeah. We should be doing. Absolutely, I think that's
right. We should be doing everything we can to build a stronger public school system to make sure that every child gets an education so they can be an independent contributor to the local economy, go out and do great things, and therefore live a life that hopefully will not be one that will need to lead to any type of prison or incarceration. But we certainly have a long way to go on that front. Mm-hmm. It's something that I'd like to see us do a better job of. You know, it cost about $65,000 to house an inmate in New York State a year. If you think about how much money just $65,000 could do in any community, and multiply that times hundreds of thousands of inmates mm-hmm. that we're paying for, it's not a good investment, especially when you're talking about a young man or a young woman that's at the very early part of their life, to put them in a situation where they're not allowed to receive an education, not allowed to grow, and then somehow expect them to survive back out in the real world when they're released. It's just not realistic, and it's not a good use of that taxpayer revenue. I'd rather see the money that we're spending so much on prisons, some of that to be diverted into educational programs that help prevent people from going to prison, and certainly providing training services so that when they get out, they have a better chance of making it.
Very tragic news recently in Orlando, Florida, where 50 people were killed in a hate and terror attack in the nation's largest mass shooting in the United States. Now, gun violence is not new, with the amount of mass shootings in 2015 that ranged around 372. All right. What is needed to be done without violating or taking away our Second Right Amendment and controlling this gun issue?
Well, look, there's too much violence in the world. Mm-hmm. There's too much violence in New York. Mm-hmm. And it's time that our elected officials at all levels of government step mm-hmm. up and try to do something about that. Mm-hmm. Certainly, I have supported in the past putting regulations and restrictions on certain types of automatic weapons. I don't think that just anybody should be able to go out and buy a high caliber, high capacity automatic weapon.
Yeah, I don't see the reason for it.
And I think that these things really have to be done at the federal level. Mm-hmm. States are really limited in what they can do towards that, because mm-hmm. states can only control what happens within their state. They can't control what happens in the state next door. Mm-hmm. So we really need our federal representatives to step up and deal with this situation to really make it effective.
Last but not least, now I don't believe that there is a strong influence that we've had once before with Rock the Vote and Vote or Die in our country at this point right now. And you know, there's a lot of people in society who don't feel as if voting is important, mainly our college students, and also believe that voting, their vote doesn't count, and if the voting system is rigged. What can you say or do to encourage people to vote in which I believe is a very important election year?
Well, every election is important. I think we must stress that. While this is certainly a very important year, every election is important. And I think one of the things that gets lost is we as voters forget that beyond just voting for president, we have other responsibilities in our democracy too. Mm-hmm. We have our local town and city and village elections. We have our state senate elections, which I'm running in. Yes. And then we have our federal elections. All those elections are important. And participating in voting for all of those various seats mm-hmm. is the best way to make sure that democracy works and that you are being well represented. Because when you go and vote in November, you're not just going to be choosing the president, you're going to be choosing your state senator, your congressman, your federal senator, your state assembly person, some local county judges, and some other local seats. And it's when you speak up and voice your opinion about who you want to serve you at all of those levels mm-hmm. that collectively it begins to make a difference. Yes, government does not always work the way we want it to. Democracy does not always work the way we want it to. Mm-hmm. I can certainly sympathize with why people might think their vote doesn't count, but it does. Mm-hmm. And you just have to remember that if you don't choose to vote, then somebody else will decide for you.
That's right.
And you're really giving up your right as an American citizen. And to give up that right and to give it to somebody else is not really a way to build an effective democracy.
Mm-hmm. Terry Gibson, once again, thank you so much for joining me on Social Thought and having this conversation with me.
Thank you. Enjoyed it. Thanks a lot. Have a good day.